Today I am talking to Dr. Sandra Brown, who serves as the co-chair of the Louisiana COVID-19 Health Equity Task Force. She's also the dean of Southern University's College of Nursing and Allied Health. How are you doing this morning?
Hello, Corey. I'm doing fine. Thanks for having me.
Last April, Governor John Bel Edwards appointed you to serve as co-chair of the Louisiana COVID-19 Health Equity Task Force. Please share with us the work that this task force has done in the past 9 months. What have we learned? Did anything stand out for you?
Well, first of all, Corey, we want to thank Governor John Bel Edwards for appointing the COVID-19 Health Equity Task Force. He heard our voices and he took action. So we're about 9 months into our work, and it has been an honor to serve as the co-chair. We have over 68 members who are on this task force who are experts from across the state of Louisiana. And so the governor asked us to do a couple of things. He asked us to provide recommendations as it relates to health inequity. He asked us to examine opportunities on how our citizens of Louisiana could get greater access to care. And he asked us to look at COVID-19 safety and prevention and to make sure that the COVID testing was available for anyone who wanted it in the community. So we've done just that. We've submitted our recommendations to him, and the full report can be accessed. It's posted on our SUS website. And so that's www.sus.edu. SUS stands for Southern University System. And so you can, read our full report. The work of the task force has also gained national attention. We were invited to present our recommendations to President Joe Biden's transition team. And so they're real interested in what we're doing in Louisiana. So you asked
that's a big honor.
It is. And we're so very proud of our President Joe Biden. And we're just so humbled that he, took an interest in what we're doing in Louisiana. What we learned, Corey, was that Louisiana ranks 49th out of 50 as one of the least healthiest states in the United States, which means that Louisiana is sick, and it was sick before COVID. We also ranked third in the nation for our poverty rate. So the health disparities that we have in our state is nothing new. It has existed for decades. So COVID, it didn't cause these health inequities, but it certainly did expose it. It's like a curtain was snatched down, and the nation got to see what was behind that curtain. And so you have people who live in poor communities, poor neighborhoods, who had worse health outcomes of, especially from COVID. So we looked at zip codes. And we know that zip codes are more important than somebody's genetic code. If you tell us your zip code, we can tell you how healthy you are and what's in your neighborhood. Access to a grocery store. Can people have do they have a nearby grocery store? Can they get to health care? And so we learned that where people live should not determine whether people live.
Exactly. How much of an effect does food have on that?
Well, obesity, in Louisiana, it's all about our food. You know that. And so, Louisiana has one of the highest rankings of obesity. And, obesity doesn't kill you, but obesity puts you at risk for other diseases that can have a bad outcome on your health, like hypertension, diabetes. So obesity is linked certainly to leading causes of hypertension and diabetes. And so we're learning that, people who have diabetes, hypertension, chronic lung disease, and are obese have worse outcomes when they get COVID. So we've certainly learned that.
Although we've seen dangerous viruses before, we've never experienced anything like this. why is this so different and so difficult to get control of?
Well, the coronavirus is a respiratory virus, and it's highly contagious because the virus can spread when a person coughs, sneezes, talks, sings, or just breathes. So you have these airborne particles that are spreading these droplets in the air. What makes this virus so difficult to get control of is that a person can have the virus, walk around with it, and not have any symptoms and, you know, spread it from person to person. And that is why it is so important to wear a mask. You know, we have this saying, I wear my mask for you, you wear your mask for me. So that is, you know, what makes this virus so dangerous and so contagious.
Okay. From a clinical perspective, what are our nurses and doctors dealing with? How are they doing? And I've read about the unprecedented toll that it's had on the mental state of a lot of our healthcare professionals.
Well, first of all, I just want to salute our frontline workers. You know, nurses, doctors, respiratory therapists, even housekeepers, those who make sure that our environment is clean and kept up. You know, it's a team effort, but it's certainly taken a toll and putting a strain on our healthcare system. So COVID is not over and our work is not done. We just have to keep reminding ourselves we can't get fatigued from COVID until COVID is fatigued. Our hospitals are short-staffed. We only have a certain number of ventilators, and so when those ventilators are taken up by COVID patients, then it puts a strain on other patients who may come into the hospital and need to get on that ventilator. And so our healthcare workers are seeing more and more, you know, people on the ventilators, particularly our African Americans. They're more likely to test positive. They're more likely to be hospitalized, and they're more likely to die from COVID-19. And this is putting, you know, certainly an emotional strain on our healthcare workers.
Mm-hmm. Okay. As a dean at a university's nursing school, you're training the next generation of health professionals. Did this pandemic show you any gaps that might affect the curriculum in the future?
Well, when the governor issued that stay-at-home order back in March, we had to pivot quickly to an online teaching format. And I have to applaud my faculty because they were able to teach these online courses, you know, to our students. First, they had to be trained on it, and then our students had to adjust to online teaching. We had to overcome a lot of challenges, you know, as it relates to technology. Some of the students who lived in like rural communities, you know, they had difficulty connecting to the internet. Some of them would have to drive miles out of their little communities just to have Wi-Fi connectivity. Some of them had computers that didn't have the necessary features. So we really had to, you know, invest and help our students and provide, you know, them with the equipment that they needed to be successful. As far as the curriculum goes, you know, I'm happy to report all of our faculty are now trained to teach courses online. We have what we call a pandemic toolbox so that, you know, if this ever happens again, we're prepared. Our university is prepared. And we've invested, you know, in a lot of, PPEs. We build plexiglass, put that in the classrooms. Make sure we have social distancing, we have mask stations, we have sanitation stations, temperature checkpoints, you know, so, you know, this pandemic has shown us, you know, what we have to do to stay safe.
Okay, well, anything else that you would like to share? Do you foresee the pandemic ending, you know, soon, or are we going to be dealing with this for a while?
Well, I like to say that 2020 is the year that changed the world. Our country is facing three pandemics. One, an economic pandemic because, you know, people are out of work. Small businesses are suffering. We're seeing massive numbers of people on food lines that we've never seen before. Our second pandemic is our health, or what we call a physiologic pandemic, and that's because of the infection rate from COVID. And then our third pandemic that we're facing is a sociologic pandemic due to this racial and social injustice that our country is facing. The one thing I've learned, Corey, that the coronavirus can't kill is racism. And the bad part about this is that all these three things, the economic pandemic, the health pandemic, and the sociologic pandemic, is happening all at the same time. I don't see a way out of this except for the vaccine. It's important that, you know, everyone has accurate information so that they can make informed decisions based on the science. Public health is built on public trust, so we've got to trust the science. And I don't know if you were aware, but an African-American scientist, Dr. Corbett, she was instrumental in the development of the vaccine. So, you know, a lot of people are hesitant about the vaccine. I hear people say, well, we're just going to wait and see, wait and see. My advice is, if this vaccine is, when your turn is called and you're offered it, you know, this is the only chance of us, you know, as another layer of protection. A lot of people are, you know, keep talking about the Tuskegee study. And yes, that left a terrible stain on the soul of our nation, but we have to trust the science. And the vaccine works, but it only works, you know, if we take it. Two doses, 21 to 28 days apart, and, you know, we've got to do it. So our message from the task force is mask up, wash up, separate, and vaccinate. So that's what we're putting on billboards, and that's, you know, our social media. And then the last thing I want to say, Corey, is thank you for bringing joy through your radio show to, you know, with the music to your listeners. You know, in South Louisiana, we sing and we dance at weddings and funerals. And so this, you know, this social isolation is really hard on our family and friends, you know, because we like to celebrate life with gatherings and music and food. It's a part of our culture. You know, it's who we are. And so just listening to your music, listening to your radio show, I know my mom tunes in every week, and that brings her great joy. So as we isolate, you know, let's celebrate, you know, listening to good music on the radio.
Yes, yes. And I definitely want to applaud you on the work that y'all have done so far, and also with the recognition from President Biden's team. Well, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Corey.